Carl, welcome to AAU Talks on AAU TV. AAU Talks is the flagship program of AAU TV, and on AAU TV we talk about everything higher education, from quality assurance to monitoring and evaluation to strategic communication, among others. That is why today we are discussing bracing through the repercussions of COVID-19, the role of youth organizations. And I have with me Mr. Benin Ahmed. He is the acting vice president of the acting secretary general of Pan-African Youth Union. I beg your pardon. I'm Bridget Ama Denteh. We are discussing a whole lot. So please stay with me. Don't change the dial. Welcome back. As I said earlier, this is AAU Talks on AAU TV. You can follow the conversation on Facebook, Association of African Universities, and then on YouTube, Association of African Universities. You're welcome.
Thank you.
So today we are discussing bracing through the repercussions of COVID-19, the role of youth organizations, and you are the acting secretary general of Pan-African Youth Union. How has it been like for the Pan-African Youth Union?
Would you let me say good morning to you and your listeners. It's good to be back once again. COVID has constrained a lot of us, but we are sailing through gradually. So as you know, one of the most affected group of people as far as this pandemic is concerned is young people. And Africa has close to 70% of its overall population being young people below the age of 35 years. So that means that the unemployment challenges that we have been battling with is compounded, and the issues of food insecurity that we have been dealing with is also compounded. So it's important for us to look at it from these points, that if you are talking about meeting SDG targets, and you are talking about eradicating poverty, you are talking about human security and welfare, you are talking about employment, you are talking about young people having good jobs and putting food on the table. What COVID has done is that the majority of young people that were in the service sector, in the aviation sector, in the tourism sector, are home. That means that households are sinking into abject poverty. And the AAU itself estimates that about 27 million jobs are going to be lost within this period. That means that if 27 million jobs are lost, your guess is as good as mine. It tells you how many households are thrown into abject poverty. But all hope is not lost. Remember, Bridget, that before COVID, we used to talk about the application of technology as a takeoff point for the fourth industrial revolution. We're talking about the future of work and Internet of Things. Mm-hmm. That means that young people would then need to begin to apply that sense of ingenuity and the skills that we acquire. You take Ghana, for instance. Mm-hmm. We have an internet penetration of close to 40-45%. That means that we would then need to learn how to use our phones and our internet properly and constructively. Yeah. It means that when you go on Facebook, you start exploring options of using your Facebook, your Instagram, your Twitter for business. Because that's what's the big deal now.
Yeah.
Because businesses will have migrated online. So largely, yes, we have been confronted with challenges, and young people form part of the bigger picture that the African Union itself paints.
Uh-huh.
Remember that in the African continent, 40% of most countries drive their revenue from oil and gas.
Yeah.
Oil prices are plunging, and we are estimated to lose about $270 billion of revenue.
Mm-hmm.
So that means that countries economically are not doing well. Mm-hmm. Africa itself, the 3.5% growth that were projected for in 2020 is declining to 1.8 and into negatives. So that means that clearly, countries are not doing well. countries that projected to create more jobs are losing them.
Yeah.
Countries that, and we're projecting that 2020 in terms of food security on the continent will be fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
The FAO projected very good yields. It's not going to be the same moving forward.
No.
So we are talking about issues of hunger and starvation. We are talking about families that either would have one meal a day, that would go days without having a meal.
Yeah.
And so these are the immediate challenges or the immediate crisis that we are confronted with as a continent. And so it's important for us, both young people and policymakers, to begin to reevaluate where we stand,
yeah,
and then try to scale up on policy measures to find solutions to these challenges.
Yeah, the challenges that COVID-19 has presented is a lot. But I want you to tell us about PYU, so that we all get to understand the basis of the conversation today.
So, the Pan-African Youth Union is the continental coordinating organization for national youth councils, youth authorities, and agencies. If you know, the Pan-African Youth Union was founded in 1962, before the OAU.
Yeah.
Because at the time, we're talking about liberation, we're talking about independence.
Mm-hmm.
And if you wanted to liberate African countries, we had two essential groups that needed to be mobilized, women and youth. So in the wisdom
the men
of
weren't even part.
Yes, in the wisdom of our forebears, two organizations were founded, the Pan-African Women Movement and the Pan-African Youth Movement, all in July 1962. And they served as foundation organizations for the founding of the OAU. And like I said, the independence struggle required young people to be out there agitating for independence. Fast forward, Africa got independent.
Mm-hmm.
It was important for us to redirect the energies of these young people constructively, more into development-oriented activities.
Okay.
So the PYM, which was the Pan-African Youth Movement, was reformed along the OAU. Okay. The OAU itself was reformed to be the Africa Union that it is today. So it became the Pan-African Youth Movement. And if you look at where we started from, we started talking policy, we started talking about youth mainstreaming, and that's when the Africa Youth Charter actually came into being. And the Africa Youth Charter became the blueprint for countries to domesticate into national youth policies that will mainstream youth development and create space for young people to sit around the table to contribute to development. The Pan-African Youth Union has its headquarters in Khartoum, Sudan.
Yeah.
And we've been there since 2011. Before then, it was in Algeria, and the headquarters was in Algeria for 31 years. As part of the reforms, it was moved to Khartoum. So I happened to run the secretariat from there, and I think that's so far so good. We've been contributing our bit in terms of how to streamline youth development on the continent and make the young people's voices heard at all levels, from the UN down to the regional organizations.
Okay, and when are you moving to Ghana? Because you've been in Khartoum forever.
Yeah, it's just like the UN or the Africa Union. I mean, it doesn't rest with one person or with
to decide.
Yes, it rests on the countries to say, look, we need to move to another country. And so if the government of Ghana feels that they would want to host it like they are doing for the AAU,
yeah,
then we would gladly move to Ghana.
Okay, I pray such a move is coordinated. Okay, so what does PYU seek to achieve?
So, like I said in my initial statement, mm-hmm. what we seek to do is to create space for the young people in the development agenda of the continent, okay. and in the integration drive of the continent.
Okay.
You can't be talking about African Renaissance and Pan-Africanism without young people having a clear understanding what it is,
okay.
and contributing to it as well. Of course, if you are talking about the 67% population mm-hmm. that are young people,
mm-hmm.
it means that the sustainability of every project, every agenda of the bigger continent rests on the shoulders of young people. If you know, Bridget, we have this agenda 2063. Most of those sitting at the helm of affairs by 2063 will not be alive. So if you don't understand it, and I don't understand it, and the young people do not buy and identify with mm-hmm. an agenda like that, clearly we are on a defeatist tangent. Yeah. And that is one of the things that we seek to achieve.
Okay.
We are talking about the CFTA, the yeah. Africa Continental Free Trade Area.
Yeah.
The majority of people that are involved in these cross-border trades are young people.
Yeah.
And for the sustainability of an initiative like that, young people will need to understand and be part of that process.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yes, our agenda is African development, our agenda is Pan-Africanism, our agenda is African integration,
okay.
and our agenda is really creating space for young people to be part of the decision-making process on the continent.
Exactly.
So, fundamentally, this is what we look at.
Wow, that's great then. Okay, so then let's move to COVID-19, mm. since you are still in the pandemic. How would you rate the response of African countries to the pandemic?
I think that if we want to pick it holistically as mm-hmm. a continent, I think that we've done fairly well. As a continent in terms of our response to COVID, as well as if you want to put it, we are blessed people.
Yeah.
And so COVID is not hit us so much. The real challenge, which I indicated in my initial remarks, is the economic impact that COVID has on Africa, which is not Africa alone,
yeah.
because African economies are interdependent on the global economy.
Yeah.
So if you are talking about African countries that have raw materials and do not process them because we do not have the industries and depend largely on China, India, the European countries in order to get commodities essential for livelihood,
mm-hmm.
then of course you tend to realize that our economy itself is very affected.
Yeah.
Take Ghana, for instance. Ghana imports almost everything from China and the rest of the world. That
yeah.
means that even when you need certain essential commodities that
yeah.
you hitherto would find easily in the shop rights or in Kantamantu, you tend to realize that there are shortages because mm-hmm. production is limited,
yeah.
and a lot of businesses are being affected.
Mm-hmm.
So, yes, in terms of the general response, I think that we've done fairly well,
mm-hmm.
but the entire world would need that multilateral approach and solidarity to sail through.
To sail through the pandemic.
COVID, yes.
Yeah. Okay, so with regards to response, when it happened, I mean, I saw a lot of videos by young people who have done, you know, something you can wash your hand under. It's sensitive to the hand. You step on it, and then water is coming. You step on it, and then the sanitizer mm. and all of that stuff. All done by young people. And I think they've done marvelously well. But to talk about the impact of the pandemic on young people and their social life, what would you say has been?
Let me first say that COVID is taught us resilience, and COVID has taught Africans that there are so many things that we can do ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
The nose mask, for instance, the hand sanitizers. Young people are beginning to make liquid soap.
Yeah.
When
I mean,
actually
it was
that
there,
tech
but
was
now
there,
it's like
but we
mass
imported
production.
Everything from China. So clearly, why were we not producing liquid soap? We're importing millions worth of liquid soap from China and from the US and Europe. COVID has taught us that we are able to produce them ourselves. Yeah. That is some form of business that is getting out there. The bit of the sense of ingenuity that I've been talking about, our government would need to reevaluate the kind of relationship that we have with the rest of the world and the kind of economic policy that we put out there. And that's why, for me, I'm excited about the one district, one factory that has been introduced in Ghana. However, we need to move beyond the sloganeering and then the rhetorics and get the job done so that we can move away from the dependency on industries or factories in India and China. I'll give an interesting example. I was in India some time back, and then I went walking in Mumbai. I get into certain areas, you see a very little shop, and then you find a machine like a grinding mill. And guess what they are making? Sweets, candies. And same candies are packaged in a way that when they come here, you think that they were made by some gigantic industry.
Industries, but it was just now, a small shop.
Exactly. So if we take that example, and then you compare what COVID is compelling us to do, it tells you that we can build our own industries, we can build our own candy shops, we can build our own toothpicking making shops, we can and gradually we are making some progress. So I want to look at the brighter side of life and the challenge that COVID is actually thrown to us as young people, so that we take that opportunity. And again, you find young people hitherto before COVID spend 70% of their time on social media posting pictures. And making arguments about issues that do not concern them. What concerns you now should be your livelihood, not what another celebrity has done out there, not what car has landed in town, because you are losing a job. And so we need to begin to rise to the occasion and use these opportunities that we have, the innovative opportunities that we have, to create a livelihood and sustainable businesses for ourselves. And I'm excited because recently in Ghana, I hardly move anywhere to buy anything. I go on Facebook if I want an air freshener. I Google it, and then I realize that there's some young person, and I order it from there. I pay with mobile money, and then a motorbike brings it. That is the kind of society that we need to begin to envisage and build. And I'll give you an example. When the vice president of this country launched the mobile money interoperability platform, a lot of us did not even understand what it was. What COVID has done is to actually bring out the importance and relevance of the mobile money interoperability. So if I bank with ADB, I can just pay, do a mobile money transaction. These are all payment gateways that, as young people, we must capitalize on to build thriving businesses using the age of internet.
Okay. So what about the impact of the pandemic on their academic life? You talked about their social life, now their academic life.
Of course, most of Africa, not just Ghana, our teaching and learning has been physical. By physical contact. It means that majority of our educational institutions do not have the required IT infrastructure for virtual teaching and learning. So of course, young people have been impacted greatly. That's why most students are home. They are not in school. I was excited that the Ministry of Education of Ghana decided they were going to start a TV channel. But how effective is that in terms of teaching and learning.
People actually learning from it. Sure.
But then, so the impact is great.
Yeah.
But then it also creates an opportunity for us to improve teaching and learning, for us to understand as a people that teaching and learning is not only through physical contact. Remember, even if you did an online course mm-hmm. and you had a degree online, people don't value it. They think that you're actually not educated.
Yeah.
But what COVID is teaching us now is to tell you that teaching and learning can be done virtually.
Yeah.
And online courses are now being rolled out. A lot of people are undertaking online courses.
Yeah.
And we are beginning to value why these systems were created.
Mm-hmm.
So our educational institutions should migrate a lot of these programs or roll out a lot of these online programs so people can do it at home. It means that you can start a business, mm-hmm. you can work whilst doing your courses online.
Yeah, exactly.
And I'm focusing on the bright side of life,
COVID.
Really, of COVID, because we have dwelled too much on the negativity of COVID. And everybody thinks that COVID grinds our lives to a halt.
Mm-hmm.
But forgetting that there are other avenues that we can take advantage of. And some are not far-reaching.
Mm-hmm.
We work with the opportunities every day.
Every day.
I think that we need to, for us, since COVID started, all our meetings, all our sessions, our seminars
online.
Have been online, and they've produced results. In fact, as I speak tomorrow, I'm addressing a workshop in South Africa tomorrow. And we are coming out with concrete resolutions and policy measures that we propose to our governments in respect of youth development. Those documents will not be viewed
mm-hmm.
as less competent
or
less
effective there.
Because we did not sit around the table. But before COVID, that mentality of thinking that efficient meetings are when you are present, when you are sitting there and having the conversations. And even in those kind of workshops and seminars you go, we end up gallivanting in town all day and then spending the last day to pull together something. So I like I said, I'm focusing on the bright side of life and that COVID is affected teaching and learning, but let us move on. Let us look at the other alternatives that technology affords us.
Okay, we are going on a break, and then when we come back, we'll talk about how we can move on and then the future plans of PYU for Africa. Do stay tuned.
Are you an institution or individual? Do you intend to organize a memorable event to be archived for future reference? Then look no further than AAU Studios, because it's your best bet. With our spacious studio and state-of-the-art media equipment such as 4K Panasonic video cameras, KinoFlow lights, assorted microphones, live streaming equipment, among others, you are sure to get the best of productions. Visit us at Trinity Avenue, East Legon, adjacent the National Accreditation Board, or contact the AAU Studios via the following email addresses: info@aau.org, aautv@aau.org, or ransford@aau.org. Alternatively, you can call us on +233 244 736280.
It's AAU Talks on AAU TV, and I still have with me Ahmed Benin, the Acting Secretary General of Pan-African Youth Union. Before we went on the break, we've talked about, you know, how COVID has affected us. We talked about the negative and then the positive side that some of us are still refusing to look at. Now, let's look at the students. How is PYU helping students in terms of health education, in terms of virtual education? How are they still accepting all of this?
Let me say, we don't just focus on students. We are a youth organization, and the All Africa Students Union is responsible for coordinating the National Students Union, of which they are a partner and work quite closely with them.
Oh,
fortunately,
okay.
The headquarters in Ghana.
Yeah.
But we coordinate the efforts of the youth councils, youth agencies, and authorities. These are councils of sovereign countries.
Mm-hmm.
So what we do is to guide as to what kinds of interventions that they put in place.
Yes, okay.
And I think that most countries have been putting quite interesting interventions.
Yeah.
Zimbabwe, South Africa, Kenya, they've been trying to put in place stimulus packages for youth startups,
mm-hmm.
in order to make them stay afloat,
mm-hmm.
providing technical assistance to young startups and youth organizations in order to keep them active and to keep them afloat. In terms of the broader support systems,
mm-hmm.
that need to be provided, we have always and continue to advise our governments and our youth councils and youth agencies and authorities on scaling up interventions.
Okay.
Because you see, when you take young people that are active, whether it be in the economic sector or they are in different categories. So young people that already had their businesses online,
mm-hmm.
actually are doing much better. How do they sustain that? Young people that, like I said, were into tourism, were into aviation, are out of business. How do we ensure that they bounce back?
Mm-hmm.
And so that's where our advocacy and our advice to the government comes in, to say, look, we need to reevaluate and look at the kind of economic policy and the kind of stimulus packages that countries must make available so that young people can access them. But let us make this clear. Even if those stimulus packages are available,
mm-hmm.
young people would need to take specific actions,
yeah.
in order to be able to access them. And even when you access them, you stay afloat. Because you see, what COVID has done is that, for instance, where young businesses would have depended for support is no longer existent, because your families, if they were those going to support your businesses, are now thinking of how
to they also stay alive. Afloat, it's true.
How do they manage their resources,
mm-hmm.
in a way that they don't go bankrupt completely and then starve?
Mm.
Then we are talking about even the capacity,
mm-hmm.
and then the job market. Look, there are so many businesses that depend on human resource outside the confines of where they operate.
Mm-hmm.
COVID has made it much more difficult for you to access these skills. And so, of course, these are all challenges that confront young people. So, largely, our advice has always been to the policymaker, to the government, to say, look, yes, young people will do their best. Young people would strive to bring their ingenuity to the table, but we need a resilient fiscal economic environment and space,
yeah.
for them to be able to
that kind of cushioning.
Cushioning to be able to survive. So,
mm-hmm.
it's important for us to look at it. And again, that's where the issue of the multilateral approach comes in. Because when African countries, and I love to zero down my conversation of on Africa, because look, like it or not, we are one of the most mistreated people,
mm-hmm.
in terms of even the global economic design.
Yeah.
So that when the IMF or World Bank is borrowing money to Korea at 0.4%, they are borrowing it to African countries at over 5-10%.
Yeah.
And so it incapacitates the government.
Mm-hmm.
But then again when I look at it, I keep asking, why as a continent we have never been able to mobilize resources within the continent itself, based on the kind of resources that we have.
Sure.
I think it's important for us to begin to look at it. But largely, all these challenges that we talk about,
mm-hmm.
zeroes down on resources. Look, the AU report that was done by the ECA indicates that Africa needs in excess of $130 billion to get a stimulus package to be able to survive COVID. because most countries are gradually sliding into recession because of the kind of economies that we are running. And the biggest or the most affected in all this will be young people.
Yeah.
Because we constitute majority, we are the most active. And even if you look at the disposition of young people on the continent in terms of poverty, unemployment, underemployment, figures that are being turned out by the ILO, tells us that young people are in crisis. So really, our governments need to sit back and reevaluate, because we need rigorous policy reform, economic policy reform, and a shift in the kind of economic policy that we have implemented over the years in an attempt to get out of
these
crises. So yes, we would keep encouraging our governments to focus on issues of youth unemployment, because these are potential destabilizing factors for every government. Mm-hmm. Because if we get the 27 million joblessness that we envisage, trust me, a lot of governments are going to be casualties, because these young people are going to get out on the street and they are going to topple a lot of governments.
Mm-hmm.
And so the government needs to understand that whilst you are doing this, you are addressing this unemployment issue, you are actually saving yourself from being kicked out.
Yeah.
Because young people will be very impatient after a couple of months, and we will be out there to support them.
Really? Okay. So let's now move to persons with disabilities who are in school. Even though you don't work directly with the students or the youth, you still have bodies that work under you. Let's look at how persons with disability or students who have some form of disability have been affected by COVID-19. So at first, if this person used to go to the classroom and listen, now he has to find a way to still continue his course while in the pandemic. What are you doing with your coordinating bodies to ensure that, okay, all these people are brought on board and nobody's left out?
Okay, so the disposition of the Pan-African Youth Union in respect of marginalized groups and people living with disability has not changed because of COVID. Our position has always been clear, which remains that states and organizations have got a responsibility to create disability-friendly environments in order to access every form of service, just like every other person, be it teaching and learning, be it economic, be it access to buildings and so on and so forth. So yes, we would continue to call on the government. You know, we zeroed down this to states because of the country specific measures that are supposed to be put in place. Remember that for us as a coordinating institution, we can put the general, the bigger blueprints or the general advice on what needs to be done. And already there are measures that have been advised by the UN, the AU, and by organizations like ours in terms of how do we respond to COVID. So if you take the UN, we have the socioeconomic response. That socioeconomic response to COVID cuts across everybody, every human being. That means that it must be implemented in a way that no group of persons feel left out.
Okay.
We have the health response.
Okay.
And that health response must be implemented in a way that everybody within the society, whether marginalized, whether this disability or
women, gender,
everybody must feel captured in that response. Then the humanitarian response, of which I would want to emphasize, that humanitarian response is particularly important for these categories of people, because they are most hit. Because even in normal times, they are marginalized. They feel left out. They feel that the society is not designed fairly to accommodate them. So this is the time for us to really look at all this, so that in the broader response that countries adopt based on the outline of the United Nations. Because remember that all these categories of response dovetail into the achievement or attainment of the SDGs, Agenda 2030, so that all the 17 SDGs are achieved. Okay. And you cannot be talking about achieving these 17 SDGs without the inclusion of people with disability or marginalized groups. So this is how we view it holistically, and we think that every human being must be captured adequately in this response.
Okay. So what are you as Pan-African Youth Union doing to help the youth during this pandemic?
I think that, like I said, what we have done and we continue to do is, one, helping us providing technical assistance through the National Youth Councils, helping them to scale up on the interventions, and also providing the needed technical material for them to be able to put out there. So, for instance, if you look at the kind of education that our councils put out there to educate young people on COVID and then on the WHO protocols and safety response, it's a responsibility for us to reach out to every young person through the National Youth Councils so that we're able to educate them to understand how to keep safe, because, like it or not, the human capital of this continent is predominantly anchored on the health of young people. And so if young people get devastated by COVID, it means that we are deteriorating the human capital of the continent, and we are gradually sliding the continent into underdevelopment and if you want to put it, poverty and deprivation.
Okay. So are there any policies or regulatory stuff to back this up?
We cannot regulate countries.
Okay.
We can advise countries. We can provide technical assistance to countries. Countries have the sovereignty to implement these actions that we advise in the interest of their citizens. But like I said, if you look at it from a multilateral perspective, countries would need to adhere to the advice that we give, and then the implementation is done in a coherent manner. So that, because if it's incoherent, Ghana may be making progress, Togo, Burkina Faso may not, but it indirectly affects us, because if they slide into extreme poverty or into a conflict situation, Ghana is going to bear the brunt.
Yeah.
And if Ghana, and vice versa.
Yeah.
So that's why when we advise, we don't zero down on country specific. We look at it from a regional perspective. We look at it as a continent.
Because so we are growing together.
We need to move along with everybody.
Okay.
And that solidarity is very important. And Africa itself will need to unite and rally around each other to get out of this, because the human security of this continent is paramount to determine the kind of development that we want to achieve. And be it CFTA, be it Agenda 2063, be it the achievement of the Agenda 2030, which are the 17 SDGs, all this will not be attainable if we do not move as a unit, we do not move as a block, and the human security of the continent is not guaranteed.
No, it's not. Okay, so we are wrapping up here. I want to hear your final words and words of advice to the youth out there and telling them to stick to the precautionary measures in place.
So my advice has always been that young people should hold governments accountable because it's the number one step or action to fight COVID-19. And that accountability in terms of resource allocation, health, infrastructure provision, and ensuring that the needed environment is created for every citizen to keep safe. Young people owe it a responsibility to society itself to hold governments accountable in this respect.
Okay.
If we do not do that, you can wash your hand as much as you can. When another person is infected, it is going to come back to you. Two is that young people themselves have a responsibility beyond taking action to keep themselves safe,
okay,
to ensure that every other person around them understands the protocols and keeps safe. And so we have that responsibility, yeah, as well. So that the responsibility of educating, that responsibility of ensuring that we are each other's keepers is very important to keep the virus away. And the final thing I would say as part of my advice to young people is that, yes, we know states have responsibilities toward us. Mm-hmm. But we also have civic responsibilities, and we must first activate our civic responsibilities as a precautionary step to protecting ourselves. And then in holding our governments accountable, we are getting them to honor their part of the social contract that we have with our government. That is very important. And let me finally say, because I'm in Ghana and I'll be speaking to my Ghanaian young people, if you think that the Ghanaian system is not working for you, get out there, register, and make a decision.
Make a decision.
If you deny yourself an opportunity to register, to make a decision, people would make the decision for you. So it's important for every young person out there. Once you're 18 years, get out there and register. That is going to really buttress the point that I made in terms of the accountability bit.
If you don't vote.
If you don't register, it means you don't have a vote.
Yeah.
And it means that if things are not going the way you want them,
hmm,
you will not have the right to correct that wrong. No. So it's important for young people to get out there to vote. And above all, stay safe, because we need every young person alive to build a resilient, prosperous Africa, one that can achieve the principles and objectives of Agenda 2063.
Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure hosting you this morning. Thank you very much too for coming on such short notice. Okay, so we've just talked about bracing through the repercussions of COVID-19, the role of youth organizations. If you watch the conversation, I know you have enjoyed it. And Ahmed Benin says that we should come together and do what we have to do. We have to take care of ourselves. Go and get registered. That way you'll be able to say something if something is not going right in your country. Thank you very much for staying tuned. I'm Bridget Ama Denteh.